Okay, we're back, sports fans. And here what we're going to be doing is looking at building a Windows Store app and what the UI needs. So my name is Atlee Hunter. For those of you that don't recognize me, know me, or haven't heard my voice screaming across some presentation room or something. What we're going to be talking about here are basically the 8 traits of a really good modern UI design. What we're looking at is that utilizing the best parts of the Microsoft UI pattern, design pattern, and making sure that we create something that's really fast and fluid, something that's lightweight, something that features the content, focuses on the content, gets the user excited, gets the user immersed in what you're trying to show them and give them, gives them the experience that they're looking for. We want it to snap and scale beautifully so that it handles all screen types, and also so that if the user brings it over to the side because they need to get something else done, that they don't forget about your application because they've had to pull it off the screen in order to get out and do something else for a second or two. Now, the other thing that you can really do is to extend the ability of your application is to utilize contracts. Make sure that you give your application the ability to share with other applications and also to share to get data from other applications, which will actually, in a lot of cases, will open up your application for more use, and especially if you choose something like an ad model, can really actually increase your revenue model as well. And like I've said before, and I'll keep saying it again, I'll keep saying it until everybody understands it, one of the most important features of your application is actually the tile, okay? It's not just the icons that we used to have, it's a tile. It's a living thing, it's a breathing thing, it's something that we can do a lot with. It's something that we can use to get the user excited about our application and bring them in again to use it over and over and over again. Like I said, one of the most common platforms for making money right now is the ad revenue model, and if you're doing things with ads and that's how you're making your money, a live tile is almost essential because you want that user back in there using it again and again and making sure that they get the most out of your application and they use it often. One of the things that we're always pushing with applications and users are pushing us, it's not us pushing them, is users want to be connected. They want to be able to get the latest information, this information now, immediately, yesterday, a week ago. They want everything, you know, instant. So we're really looking at, what we really want to do is look at how your application can make use of cloud services and different other features like that, as well as making use of things like roaming storage. As I've talked about in other talks, roaming storage gives you the ability to share information, settings, and different things with your application, share it with other copies of itself on other people's, on the same person's device in other locations. So when it comes right down to it, what we really want to do is explore the UI, make sure that we can utilize the best tools and the best practices to create a really great experience for the users. So one of the best ways to do that is with built-in controls. It's where we all start from. We all open up Visual Studio rather, and start and go, okay, what's my toolbox got in it for this version in this particular platform? That's great. I get to do this and this and this and this. Well, we're going to explore some of these built-in controls because they're a little different than they used to be, a lot different than the visual controls we've had before, because they're a much cleaner UI. They're not as much Chrome. It's not all corners and rounded and depth and using things that make them look sunken or raised up or lowered or whatever else. They're very, very clean controls that try to get the information and the data and the use of the control itself across cleanly and effectively, which is helps you to lead to the exact experience that you're looking for your users. Also, one of the things I keep saying to people, what you do is you design for touch, okay? You utilize the concept that your application, more and more applications are being used primarily for touch, or at least a great portion of it by touch, because a lot of these new devices are coming out with touch screens. I even have a touch screen for my desktop now. I didn't think I was going to be all that excited about touch until I actually got a tablet that I was using and making Windows apps on, and I was able to utilize it, and now I find I'm poking at my screen all the time on my laptop with my finger, and now all I want is a touch device. So, and you'll find that users are like that too. So what you do is you design for touch, the keyboard and the mouse will just be there, okay? So if you work on the thought of making your controls accessible and big enough and spaced out well enough so that they're usable by hands, by fingers, you've got to remember, not everybody's fingers are the exact same size as yours, mine. Not the exact same size as everybody else's. You've got to realize that you're building this experience for the user, and you can do that really, really effectively and really cleanly and easily with the new UI controls. Now, the other great thing is that there's a lot of these controls. They're all native to HTML and they're native to XAML. So you can utilize them whether you're making your application in HTML5 and JavaScript, or whether you're using C# and XAML, VB, whether you're using them in C++ and XAML too, which is another great exciting feature of the new platforms. So first thing we're going to look at is the toggle switch. Okay, the toggle switch control, anybody that's done any WPF or done any HTML, actually, it looks very, very similar to an HTML type control because it's built using XML. It's a marked XML. So if we look at here, we've got our toggle switch, and we can see that we give it a header, which basically shows that it's got this name here on the text. So we've said that it's going to be Wi-Fi networking, and we have an on and off switch. So it gives a very clean, effective way to turn something on and off. And it's actually a lot more touch friendly than using a simple checkbox can be. So instead of creating a checkbox and resizing it, sometimes the toggle switch is the right answer. So you might definitely want to take a look at that and consider it for your application use. And then in C++, or in C# rather, in your code behind, all you'd have to do is add a new event handler, and basically you can trap for when it's been toggled on or off. So you can do something at the time it's been toggled, or you can then reference the actual value of the toggle switch. You can also bind to the value of the toggle switch so that you can use it in a MVVM situation, so that you can then get your information directly out to your main or your view model, so that you're not utilizing it right in the code behind. So in HTML, it's very similar, but a little bit different document, or a little bit different text in the control. You're going to see that you're using the data-win-controls set. Okay, and that's where your controls are located. And you're basically telling it that it's a winjs.ui.toggle. And basically you can set the options, and there are more options than just the title. It's sort of like setting the properties of that particular control right there in the UI of the toggle switch. And you give it an ID. And you'll see that it comes out on the screen looking the exact same way. Once you've compiled it and run it in HTML5, or in C# XAML, you're going to see that it will show up on the screen the exact same way. The user won't know the difference of what platform you used. It'll just know that that's the experience, that's the UI, that's the control they're using, which is really nice because you can create a very, very common experience using the language that you're comfortable with. So some of the everyday widgets that we have are ones that we've known for a long time and we're really used to. A couple of them are new. So the ones that we know, we have buttons, but the buttons look a little different too. You can actually have a button that uses a glyph and then it has a circle around it. So for the common back button that is on most Windows 8 applications that have more than one screen, you'll see that common back button up in the left-hand corner. And that is a very, very common artifact of a Windows 8 application. You do have the checkboxes, but I find, like I said, more and more, the more I program for touch, the more I find that I'm using things like toggle switches, toggle buttons, things like that. You also have a time picker and a date picker, which are a little bit different. You'll see that the date picker actually divides up the month, the day, and the year into separate basic combo boxes. And what happens is they open in place, and then you can select just the month, or just the day, or just the year. And that makes a really, really nice, easy to use experience for the user, because they can change the one piece of the date they need to change. And that's something that I find is a much better design than the old calendar that used to pop up and then have to go in and cycle through and select the date. I found those kind of frustrating. They're definitely frustrating to use in touch, because the calendar would have to be half the size of the screen. So this gives you a much cleaner, effective control to use. You also have things that are a little bit new, like the progress ring. Okay, so the progress ring, instead of just a progress bar, you have a progress ring that can indicate something's happening in the background without giving it a definitive time limit. So it's sort of an ongoing, hey, I'm doing something. When this ring stops, I'm done. Also, the ratings control is something that's really cool and a lot of fun. I've developed a couple apps that use a rating control, and people really like it. It gives them the ability to basically just poke at a star, and that's how much they like or dislike something. And it can make a really, really neat effect for both your HTML5 apps and for your C# XAML apps, to give the users to give their feedback either on the app directly if you want to make it so they can send their feedback directly to you, or if they're just, hey, I like this, I don't like this, and this is what the app does. It tells people what they like or what they don't like. You have traditional slider controls, but they look a little different now. They don't have the same bar they used to have there. More of a clean, thinner UI design, and it gives you the ability to actually see the number as you're sliding across. So it is quite a nice change from the traditional AI UI we used to have. The list box is a new control, or not really a new control, but it operates a little bit differently than it used to operate. You have the ability, actually it operates similarly, but when you're using it, you're going to use it a little bit differently, because you got to remember that the items inside the list box have to be accessible through hand. So it's accessible through touch, so you want to keep the items a little farther apart. You're going to notice that in different controls, you're going to see that items are spaced a lot farther apart, and that's to enable for that touch forward interface. You have your traditional ones that you're used to, combo box, radio button, and the hyperlink controls, and those are also carried forward. So you can actually take any of these items and you can give them a custom styling. You can make them look completely different. So one of the things I find that I do most of the time with my buttons is I don't put text on my buttons as often anymore. Or if I put text on it, it's small text that's put in as an after piece to sort of reaffirm what the image is that I put on the button. So I try to use really nice, clean, metro-style images to create something that's very quick and easy for the user to identify with. And that's one of the really nice advantages of this platform, is that it's made really, really easy to include an image inside a button and to customize it and formalize it. And you can do the same thing as with all of them, as you can see here. The checkbox, we have I really like this, I really don't like this. Or the ratings, we've changed the stars now, are hot peppers. How spicy is this thing? So which is great for, I think you'll see it in the a couple of the cooking apps that are on the store, they use that. You can also create a toggle switch that looks a lot more like a traditional switch that you'd see on old style radio. The date and time picker, you can set colorings and a bunch of different things. In the radio button, you'll see they have the thumbs up and thumbs down. So there's a lot of really fun things you can do with the controls. You can style them just about any way you want, because they're very, very extendable. There's a lot of things you can do utilizing the controls. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at a couple of the everyday widgets and a couple of the ways that I've implemented them. I'm actually going to open up an application that I've done myself, and we're going to take a look at how I utilized a couple of things like buttons and other things. So we're just going to open up Visual Studio here. And whoops. Okay, so we're going to look at, this is an application I created called Sketchboard. And it's a really simple application, but it's kind of fun. And so what I'm going to do here is we're going to take a quick look at how I've customized my buttons. Okay, so I've created buttons here, and I want this to be my small pen button. And we're actually just going to get rid of this so we can see a little bit more of it. And we're going to move this over here. Okay, so basically here we can see that I've given it a tag, which is very common. I've given a click identifier, which is also very common. Now, I've set a border brush. Now, the border brush is the edge of the control, so that basically allows you to stylize the control and show the bounds of that control. So in this one, I've decided to make it transparent because I don't want to directly identify the bounds of it, and I'd actually like it to sort of blend more in with the rest of that part of the UI. So inside here, inside the button here, we have something called the button content. Now, one of the really nice things that you can do is that if I were to take this and comment this out, I could actually set the content in here and just set it to some text, right? And if we make this, if we bring this up to about 60%, and we can go up and see this here, just 1 second. I'm not seeing it. Interesting. It's not giving me the scroll across that I want. There we go. I had actually made it too small. So you can see here that my button has changed to text. So I was very easily able to just change the content and set the content directly to text, and now that becomes my button there. Now, instead though, what I wanted to do is I wanted to do something a little more custom. So I wanted to add some text and a button and an image to it. So what I did was I added inside my button content, which is basically an extension of that button property, I've now put in a stack panel. Stack panel is one of the controls that you use to organize and to lay out controls. You can either stack things on top of each other or stack things beside each other. So you can set the orientation to horizontal and then you're stacking things beside each other. If I'm using it the way I'm using it now, it's going to stack things directly on top, as we can see here, with the fact that I have an image of a small pen and then I have text block. A text block is very similar to your label control that you would have been using in desktop apps previously. So my text here says small, and I've got my image of my button, and basically that together has made the content of my button. So now I have a very easy to understand button that you can look at it quickly and get what it is. But if you're not quite sure, you can look at the smaller text underneath and get that last piece. So it gives my users an ability to really quickly and effectively utilize my application. And if they're not quite sure, they can look at it a little bit closer and they can get a little bit more clarification. So that's an example of how you can customize one of the widgets. So we will go back to our deck here, and text editing is something that's very, very, very common. I mean, most applications out there are either consumption or they're CRUD apps. Now, by CRUD, I mean create. CRUD, create. Yeah, thanks. Create, read, update, or delete. Oh my gosh, where's my mind today? Anyways, so in utilizing that, anything that we want to update or add, or create rather, we need to have some sort of way of getting data into it. One of the most common things is using text editing controls. So one of the nice things is that we have similar controls that we're used to, but they're actually been built with a touch forward interface. So you can see how the common single line text box has basically the text box that we have. But once it has text in it, it actually adds a clear button right here. So that's easy to hit with a finger and empty the field without having us having to code anything in it to select all and delete and do all of those things. So it gives it a very, very effective touch forward sort of presence to the particular control. Now we also have the multi-line text box controls you can use to extend and allow a much larger selection of editing. You also have rich text box controls, which are fantastic because you can really customize and pattern those and allow the users to create very, very, very rich documentation or rich entries in your application. And you have password text box, which also has an interesting button on it that actually has a reveal button. And so what will happen is when they type their password in, you can't see it, but if they reach forward and touch, they can verify that they've typed that password correctly in a split second and be able to tell that they can go forward without, you know, having made a mistake. So those are a couple of the most commonly used text editing controls. Now, some of the behaviors, though, that we have is you can really, really see how all of the controls are already built in to have cut, copy, and paste in them. They also have spell checking built into them, and we don't have to do anything to enable that. That's already just there, okay? They also have touch, so when the user taps on a particular word, or they get basically that gets selected, and they get these two basic round dots on the other side that show that they can extend that selection out one way or the other so that they can select either one or several words or whole sections of text. And then they also have the ability of taking advantage of all of these features using the keyboard and mouse in traditional methods that they're used to, but they're also built touch forward. So it's very, very easy to basically see, hey, look, I've got an application. It looks very clean, very robust. It looks very polished because it's got the things like the spell check and the cut, copy, paste and all of those features in it built into it so they can the users can use it the way they're expecting to use their device. So with the touch keyboard, one of the things that I always try to remember is that I'm laying out all of my controls on my application so that if a control needs the keyboard, I've taken that into account that it may not actually be a physical keyboard. It actually may be the on-screen keyboard, the touch keyboard that's on the device itself. So you want to think about that when you're looking at how you're laying out your controls and where things are positioned. One of the nice things here, though, is that you have a very, very robust keyboard that allows you to set different scopes for it. So you have the ability to say, this is a standard keyboard, or I'm building a keyboard that needs email. So it will pattern it and allow you basically lovely to have the at symbol right here and the .com down there so that users can quickly and effectively type things in and get things done much more quickly than they could normally with a traditional keyboard because they're typing less strokes. They're basically hitting one thing to mean one or more things. One of the nice things about the .com is it also will customize to their particular region. So if they're using your application in the UK, well, quite often they're going to be sending a .co.uk URL or email address than a .com email address. So it'll actually have .co.ua, and if they press and hold it, they can go back and use .com as well. So it's really, really nice because it gives a very robust ability for the users, and it gives it to you in your app without any extra work. Same thing here with the numbers. You have the ability to have the numbers pad pop up that gives you all of the numbers, the digits that you need, plus all the symbols that you would associate with normal number usage. So it makes it really easy and effective to set that up. Okay, so basically the next thing we want to look at is how you can command surfaces, how you can utilize the space in your application to make sure that you're sharing the information the most effective way. So what you're really looking at is what things allow in the UI and the controls allow you the ability to really properly share with the user and create a really great experience for them. So one of the great things is the app bar. The app bar is built so that it basically holds your buttons for commonly used actions, navigation, and some of the things that we do normally need buttons for, but it can hold them up out of the way of the rest of the content, so it doesn't have to just be sitting there. You can set it using the is sticky and is open properties of the app bar. You can set it to stay and hold there, but in most cases what you're doing is the app bar is not available until the user needs it, so you can actually set it to open at a specific time when they enter a control where that particular button is needed. Or for example, I've got an application where when it's finished everything, it prompts you to save, and then once you click OK, the app bar pops up so that you can see the save button. So it's right there. The user doesn't even have to swipe or think about it. The button's right there and available to them, but it's been hidden the whole time. So it offers a really, really nice experience. So one of the other great things is the context menu. You have the ability to have the cut, copy, and paste pretty much everywhere without having to have it take over any space by being buttons or any other features. Now, also one of the things that I really like to use is if you have something that you're either trying to get a quick entry or you're trying to get the user's focus on one particular thing, you have the ability to use a flyout, which is basically almost like what we would consider a modal dialog box in previous versions or a dialog box. And basically it will pop up and allow you to, you can even use transitions to make it show up like it's appearing from one side or the other. But it basically will show up and do what it needs to do, and then you can dismiss it and have it go away afterwards. Now, one of the other big features is the settings pane. So I find this really effective because what happens is the users, one of the biggest complaints I always got from users, especially in working in corporate applications, was where do I find this setting, or where do I find that piece, or how do I change this, or how do I modify that? Well, now every Windows 8 application has the ability to utilize the settings charm. Okay, and the settings charm is where you should be putting your information, where you should be putting the place where users change how the application reacts or what information they need to sort of put in. So for example, login information, you can have it set that if the user's logged in and they save their login information, they can change it using the settings charms to go back and modify their login information. Or for example, I have an application that helps users track when something's happened from a certain date. So I basically put in the settings charm, the ability to set or change that date. There's a way to have it in your application, have it in the common place, have it in a place where the users will recognize it and understand it and will react to it and cut down the confusion for users. So it's definitely something you should look at. Message dialog in Windows 8 is actually pretty cool because it's much different than the message dialogs have been in previous versions of Windows. The message dialog in previous versions of Windows would appear basically anywhere on the screen unless, of course, you told it to be in the absolute center. And now the message dialog turns up as a complete strip across your application where you can either stylize that strip and have it show and say what you want it to say, or you can use the default settings and it will follow the user's preference for their colors and their themes of their device. But the nice thing is about being across the strip, you don't have the opportunity really to miss the dialog box or the user to sort of ignore it or forget about it. So you use the dialog box sparingly because you don't want to create that experience when it's not necessary. But at the times when a dialog box is necessary to get the user's attention, you have the user's attention because it's basically right there. It's in their face and it gets that information across. And then you also have a really, really nice tooltip control that allows you to basically see the information that you want to have seen based on what they're focused on or they've touched on the application. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take a quick look at what an app bar is. An app bar, like I said, is a great way of putting your buttons and everything together. So we're going to go back into my sketchboard application. Now you notice here that in this application, you'll see that the in the application, it's completely clear and you can't really see that nothing's there. The whole screen is basically clear and open and nothing's taking up anything. But what we've got here is we have an app bar that when we utilize the app bar, when the app bar is brought forward, it gives us the user access to the buttons and the commands that we want to give them access to in the application in that particular area. Now, traditionally what you want to realize is that there's two places for the app bar. There's a top app bar and there's a bottom app bar. So the top app bar is traditionally used for navigation, getting from point A to point B, going through different pages and getting around in your application. The bottom app bar tends to be for controls that lead to that relate to the content or actions that relate to the content on the page they're looking at. Now, true to my own form, I've ignored that and I've put all of my action buttons on the top, which may or may not be the right methodology, but you have to look at what the use case of your particular application is. The advisory, though, is that you usually navigate top for your navigation because that's what users are used to. In this one, I found that it worked out really well for me to put my things for changing all the button or changing all of the fonts and colors on the screen at the top because I was going to use the bottom for resetting and saving, and I didn't want to have too many buttons in one spot. So what I did here was in the top app bar, you'll see that you have a page.top app bar. Okay, that's basically, that declares the app bar space. Then inside the inside this container, you're actually going to put another container control called an app bar. I know it seems kind of redundant, but it's basically the app bar itself is the control that you're putting. The page.top app bar just identifies to the OS where it's putting this particular control, how it's laying it out. So this app bar control has the ability to, I can either set it to visible. Here again, I've set the border brush to transparent. We also have a couple of other very, very important properties. One is open. Okay, and that tells you whether the app bar is open or not. If I set the is open to true, and we went back to our screen here, we'd see that now the app bar is appearing as down all the time, whether we're focused on it or not. And what that basically does is it gives me the ability to create more of a static situation. But it's actually not a static situation as you would think of it, because right now if I started this application up, the application would start, the app bar would be down, but as soon as the user touched something on the screen, the app bar would go away. Okay, now in order for the app bar to stay there all the time, I'd have to set a second property, and that would be the is sticky property. Now, the is sticky means that the app bar does not react to the UI, the user touching controls on the rest of the UI. It just stays in whatever position it's in until it's closed programmatically. So you can set the is sticky and have the is open not be true. And then what will happen is when the user swipes it, it'll come down, but then it'll stay open. So you want to make sure that you're properly managing those two particular properties to best suit your use case, because you don't want to end up giving a confusing user experience. You want to give the right user experience, but you have a lot of flexibility. So you can do a lot of different things. So my application, I don't use either one of those for this particular one, but I thought it was important to show you. Now you see here that I've actually customized the color that I've used in my background. And by doing this, I actually extended out the background property the same way I extended out the context property in the button previously. I can do that with the background as well. I can set the background to a picture. I can set it to a more complex control set, so I can really customize it. Here I'm just doing, as an example, just showing you, I've set a solid color brush and I've set it to a custom color. So this gives me the ability to customize that. And I've set the opacity to be 0.9, so that means it's just a little bit see-through. You can just see through it, but not completely. So you can see that there's something behind it. Now, what I've done here is in the app bar, I've basically set up a grid. A grid is one of the container controls used in Windows 8 and in XAML applications. And I've set the column definitions to be half of the screen each. So what'll happen is now I've got a top app bar that has two sections, the left section and the right section. In that, I've applied a view box. Now, a view box is a really powerful control that allows you to basically have your application size and scale itself. Okay, and we'll talk a little bit more about scaling later, but it allows it to size and scale itself so it fits screens more effectively and it makes use of the space as best as it can. I've set the max height of my view box to 150, because if I didn't, the view box would extend and take up the whole screen if it could. So basically, you want to make sure that if you're using a view box, you set the max and min properties to where you want it to be, so that it doesn't scale itself up or down too far out of the ranges of what you want. Inside the view box, I put a stack panel, which we saw before in the button control. So that's, again, this time I've oriented it horizontal, so now I'm stacking things beside each other. So we talked about that before. I can either stack things on top or beside. Here I'm stacking them beside. I've told it to be in the grid zero column, so that means in the first or the left side of the app bar, and now I've put in my buttons. So in my buttons, as we saw before, I've got my custom button content, and I've got my different buttons. So I close up my stack panel in my view box, and then I have another view box open on the other side that contains the buttons for the right-hand side of my app bar. So again, as I showed before, max height 150, grid column 1, horizontal alignment, set to right. So now I've centered and told my buttons to always go and lean towards the right. So if I put two or three buttons there, they're not sitting out in the middle of the app bar, they're sitting off to the left. So I know that I can define by placement and by control set that these go together and these go together on this side. So this gives us a really, really nice effective experience. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna start up the simulator here, and we're gonna start up and take a quick look at what this application looks like, what the app bar looks like, and how it looks when we swipe it and we snap it. So that's one of the other things that we wanna look at as well. So we open up the Sketchboard app, and I have my app really clear and open. And you can see that I've got a top and I've got a bottom app bar. So I've got my different buttons here. So I have my different items laid out, and then I've got my save and my reset or delete button. Now if I snap this now, and then I do this again, you'll see that my buttons have actually scaled themselves. So they scaled themselves to share the space. These ones have scaled up here, and I've left these nice and big because I wanted the user to be able to really quickly and easily save or delete, and I figured I only need to share it between those two buttons. So you'll see that utilizing the view box and utilizing the app bars, I'm able to extend the abilities of the application to do an awful lot with what looks like a completely empty screen. So we will go back to our deck now, and we'll talk about presenting data. So there are a lot of different really, really cool ways to lay out data and to get information out. And one of the things that we're really focusing on in Windows 8 is being content forward, right? We're trying to make sure that the information is the star, right? This is what people are looking at. All of these new apps, especially on tablets and phones and all of these big screens and different things, it's all about seeing the content. People don't want to see 800 buttons. They don't want to have all sorts of things around things, bordering things and everything else. You can use some really, really great data controls to present the data and lay it out in something that basically invites the user to explore it and find more. So some of the best ones are the list view, the grid view, and the flip view. Flip view is a lot of fun. Grid view is fantastic for laying out tons of data and laying it out in so many different ways that it boggles the mind sometimes. And list view is a really, really nice take on the traditional list box. Okay, it gives you a much more immersed and a much more customizable experience than we've previously had. We also have the ability to group, select, and animate different things. So there's a lot of built-in animations, a lot of built-in transitions, the ability to flip and roll and move things around. There's also all of these controls are able to select one or multiples of the objects that are inside, and you have the ability to group things within these controls. So you can set it up so that items within the grid viewer are grouped together, and that allows some really, really interesting experiences using semantic view, or zoom rather. So semantic zoom, what a good segue. Awesome, it's almost like I knew that was there. So this gives you the ability to really sort of group and piece information and allow the users to explore information using gestures and using the keyboard and mouse to really explore in a very, very hierarchical method, in a much better experience than they have been able to previously. So you can actually zoom down and see things in an overview, or you can zoom in and look at the details of them. And semantic zoom gives you a really, really great tool to be able to do that with. So getting started with list view, okay? So basically, we're gonna look at an HTML list view. So we've got our list view that basically shows, you know, a list of items and they're grouped together. So first of all, what we do is we start off with data. We need our data source. So we've got our source of data, where we want to get our information, where our pictures are, where our items are, and we want to bind it to the list view. So what we do is we also then have to apply it to the item renderer, okay? So we have to apply it to the to be laid out and rendered in the way that we want it to be laid out using CSS. And then we have our layout. We have our layout of what our template looks like. How do we position the particular pieces of data within that list view item? So our list view item might contain just the name and the picture, but how do we lay those out? Do we put the picture beside it? Do we put the picture over it? What's the layout? Does it have several pieces of text? And do we want to show the title and then maybe a little bit of the description, enough to get the user interested and excited and want to read more? So we can use ellipses to utilize that feature. So when we look at the list view and how we did the data templating, we can see that here in HTML, we've got an extension of the data win controls, which is the same control set that we saw utilized earlier. So basically we have a template, which is a standard templating control that basically allows us to really explore and utilize the layout the way we want it to be. We get to customize just about everything. So we've set up our basically identified this div as a template. Then we identify this, oops, sorry about that. We identify that particular div as the text item, right? We identified that as the item. Then we go in and we add the image, which is basically another control that basically, identifies it as the image, which we will then be able to affect in our CSS to give us the right layout for that particular object. Then we have our div class, which is our small item text detail. So we then would assign our detail would show up in that particular piece. So inside here, we have to call WinJS. Okay, so the WinJS is an extension of the JavaScript basic libraries, and the WinJS.UI.processAll basically tells the WinJS to go in and grab all the information and get it all ready for layout and then present it to this particular presenter. So in here we've got another div, and we basically have identified that it's a control and told it it's a list view control. We've told it what the icon template is. We've told it what our data source is, and our item data source has been set in our JavaScript behind, and we can tell it a few of the different properties. And this is sort of another example of that data-win.options that we saw in previous controls, and it shows it with a little bit more features. So it allows you to see how you're setting these properties at design time to be set up and utilized at runtime. So let's look at the exact same type of thing, but this time it's a grid view, not a list view, and we'll look at the grid view in XAML. So in the grid view in XAML, we've got our item source, which is our data, which is our starting point for everything, and then our item template, very close, very similar to the renderer on the HTML. And then we have our items panel. So that basically tells us what does the item container look like. And then we've got, basically that defines the items container style. So we've got our ability to format every single piece of this element, put it all together, and create a really nice, rich experience. So we'll take a look at the data template here. The data template is a standard templating control or container that allows us to put inside of it other controls and basically to indicate the template for this particular data set. And so what we've got here is we've got our stack panel, which we're basically putting items horizontally again. We were looking at the image source. We've got, we have it bound to the image, so we're dynamically binding this using the binding to basically utilize the image as the source of that. And then we have our text block, where we're actually setting up a static resource of item text style. So one of the nice things that you'll find in the C# XAML applications for Windows 8 is you'll find a common folder, and inside that you'll have the common styles .xaml. And that will contain a number of really, really useful styles that you can apply to it, but you can also go in and edit them because it's sort of almost like a XAML version of a CSS page. So you get to go in and set custom styles that would affect your entire application, and you can access them directly using the static resource. In here, what we've done is we've set up a style here. We've called it storefront tile style, and we're setting up a style specifically for this particular control set that we're then applying a bunch of different properties to. And inside the grid itself, inside the grid view itself, we've actually applied the item template, the item container style, and given it a border brush. So this basically allows us to create that immersive experience very quickly and effectively in XAML. So we'll look at some layouts and views. A couple of the things that you really want to think about when you're talking about Windows 8 design is the fact that it's a much different paradigm than some of the other platforms have. There are an infinite number of screen sizes available for Windows 8. They can go from the very small. We can look at tablets that are 5 to 7 inches. We can look at screens that are 84 inches. and it's quite fascinating, and there's everything in between. You also have to think about things like Snap and Portrait. How do you handle those other layouts, and how does your application handle those? Can you properly lay out your data to show that it's aware and it's effective in a portrait layout? Can you give enough information in a Snap layout to keep the user engaged and keep the user having that application open so that they will come back to it sooner? And then one of the other things we really want to look at is scaling and pixel density, and how do we affect that, and what's the best way to affect that without losing the effect or the richness of the experience we're trying to portray. So why we care? If you properly set your application to handle different screen sizes, you're going to be able to show the right amount of data based on the screen size. You don't necessarily want to scale everything down to the lowest common denominator, nor do you want to restrict yourself so that when a screen is huge, that you're only showing a little bit of data, but it's all huge and enormous fonts and everything else. You also, like I said, want to keep your users engage longer, which is why you really, really invest in a good Snap view experience. And again, supporting different pixel densities will really ensure that your application always looks crisp and clear, and you don't end up with that weird pixelated look under certain resolutions, under certain screen types. So the user experience, right? We want to really, really concentrate on how that user experience is maintained, and we want to make sure that the apps are as clean, as effective, and immersive as possible. We're really trying to get the user involved so that they get what they want out of the application, either to get something done quickly and effectively, or to lose themselves for a while in the data that we're providing, in the information that we're providing, the experience that we're providing. The minimum app resolution is 1024 by 768. And I'm so glad they finally got rid of the 800 by 600. That was probably one of my favorite things about this. I'm like, oh, fantastic. Finally, a bigger resolution, a bigger UI. I can do more with the screen. There's more available. Now, while that's true, you do have to be aware that you have to be placing and sizing your controls for touch. So think about that when you're looking at your app design. Now, one of the big commonalities is that you usually start to build your application for 1366 by 768. If you build your application based on that screen size, you're probably going to hit the largest number of applications or of devices and of systems and have a very nice, clean, immersive experience for them. You don't necessarily want to go too much below that. One of the things you do want to realize is that at Snapped View, your application is going to show basically at 1024 by 768 in field view, or in field view. The Snap View would take up 346 pixels, I believe. So always trying to take as much advantage of the screen real estate as you can. Make sure that you're utilizing all of the screen, and you make sure that you're actually utilizing the space off the screen as well. Taking advantage of the screen real estate doesn't just mean the screen itself. Make sure that your application creates an immersive enough experience that if you've got information that's going to be going off the screen and the users need to scroll, make sure that you're utilizing the screen itself to show that there's more information off the screen, right? Make sure that there's that little bit of feed coming in on the side so the users can see that there's more and they'll continue to explore and get more out of your application. Now, when building for screen size, you really want to keep, you want to try and figure out what's the best methodology for what you're doing. And it's all about use case, right? We can't really say this is the only way you do it. But one of the things you do really want to do is make sure that you always look at what your use case is and what will give the best experience to the user. So in some cases, it's really good to have an adaptive control set. So using things like grid view and list view, which will expand and grow with your screen size and present as much data as they can in the sphere that they're given. Now, in other cases, let's say, for example, you're building a game or a control that needs to be very, very fixed and it's always got to be taking up this much of the screen. Well, you can set up a layout that uses the view box control like I did with my previous application to make sure that you're utilizing the most that you can out of the screen and not showing like black edges or extra size or space on the sides, and that you can really, really keep that immersive experience no matter what the screen size becomes. So adaptive controls and screen size. You've got list view in HTML5 and you've got a grid view and list view in XAML. So you've got these controls that will, as I said, will grow to encompass whatever size you've given them. So if I set up a grid view and I tell it that the height is X amount, well then it will stay to that height, but it will try to fill as much information width-wise as it can. So what I usually try to do is try to keep my other controls bound and set to the placement that they have to be, then set margins on things like grid views and list views so that they can then grow to take up as much space as they can without actually overlapping or encroaching on other spaces because they're using the margins to sort of dictate their bounds. So managing the wireframe in HTML5, you're really looking at utilizing your CSS, and it divides your spaces into grids and rows, or sorry, into rows and columns in a grid, and allows you to really sort of set up very, very finite and very flexible UI concerns for your applications in HTML5. One of the nice features is the flexbox. Okay, in CSS, you can set up the flexbox to basically set up control stacking, and you can lay things out very much like a stack panel. It's really, really nice to use. So grid layout and setting up your screen size. You can set up your screen size and your structure and assign content to those specific cells. So in your CSS, you actually define your grid, you lay it out and you tell it what these grid columns are going to be, and then you tell your controls themselves which columns that they're going to be in and which rows they're going to be in. So for example, here's an example of utilizing that, where we've set up different columns to set a list in one side, the controls holding the text are in another one, then we've got our titles, we've got our menus, our menu items, and it creates a very, very rich and immersive experience and creates it very cleanly and effectively. So HTML is adaptive by nature. And so a lot of times it will naturally try to grow and expand the way that you want it to, but it also can be a challenge, so you need to make sure that you stay sort of aware of that, that even though you're compiling it for native, it is still originally HTML that that was compiled, so it's going to take on some of those properties as well. So when you're managing your size in XAML, it's a little bit different than it is in HTML. So you've got a grid, and you can set fixed sizes, and you can also set variable sizes in grids. And the star sizing is for a more fluid layout. And then you've got the stack panel, which is similar to the HTML counterpart of the flow control. And again, this is basically would be the same layout built using those features. So you could have your grid features to have set the column sizes, and then you could have row features to set the row heights, and then you could even set a stack panel here to lay these out one on top of the other. So doing a fixed layout in XAML is really easy, as you can see here, and as you saw previously in my other application where we looked at it, the column definition I used was variable, so I used a 0.5 star, which meant give me half of the whole. Here what we're saying is column definition, the width is 250 pixels. So that will say that we've got three columns that are 250 pixels each, and then in this we've decided to put a rectangle, fill it red, and put it in column one, which would be the middle column. And that's what we would get. Now, you'll notice too, though, that the column definition on the third one, it looks like it's taken up much more than 250 pixels. It's because the last column on the grid, if you've defined all the columns previously, the last column will take up whatever space is left, even though it's been defined as 250 pixels, unless there's another control beside it, or another control that's basically will take up that space. It will take up whatever space is available. So a fluid layout in XAML is, like I said, star sizing. So that's similar to what I'd shown in my other application where I was actually using a 0.5 of half of all. This is just saying, give me 250 pixels on the first column. Make sure you use everything that's available in the middle column, but give me 250 pixels on the last column. So basically what that comes out is as that. So as you can see, as opposed to the other one where the 250 pixels on the end took up the rest of the screen, this one has said, I've defined the outer bounds of the two, and the inner one is fluid, so it will take up as much space as it can. So fluid layout in XAML, you can actually set things up to be as big as they can be. Now, the horizontal alignment can be set to left, right, center. It can also be set to stretch, so it will take up all the space that's available. So in this case here, we've got the column set up specifically so that this column is 80 pixels. This column is one half of what's left, and this is one third of what's left, and the other one is two thirds of what's left. So by using the star and the two star, that means it will take up twice as much as the remaining last piece has been given. It can be a little confusing sometimes when you look at it, but once you've played around with it a little bit, you'll understand it pretty effectively. So setting something as a fixed and scaling it to fit, that's something I've done in a couple of applications. I found that it worked really, really nicely and really effectively. So in this situation, we've got a reversey game or a marble game where we want to make sure that that screen always looks like that screen every single time, no matter what we're doing and no matter what screen we're on. So in order to do that, what we do is we set up a view box. And the view box basically scales things to fit. So it basically takes advantage of all of the screen sizes available and actually all of the bounds that you've given it, right? So in HTML5, you can see that we've got the WinUI view box, and we set the width and the height to be, you know, whatever we've decided to be. Now that view box will be that area, okay? And it'll always be that area. Now, if we had not set it, it would expand to take up whatever size of whatever screen was there. Now, one of the other really, really important things when designing your UI for Windows 8 is thinking about the different layouts, okay? The different screen layout modifications that can occur. One of the most important is snap and portrait, okay? One of the most important drivers, sorry, is Snap. Porch is also incredibly important for, especially for certain types of applications, work better as a portrait application than they do as a landscape application. But the one I think that you'll probably find that you'll most commonly run into is the necessity for handling a snap, okay? And that's when the user has dragged the application down and pinned it to the side so that they can see something else in the major part of the screen. Now, handling a good snap or giving a good snapped experience really can actually make or break an application. I've actually have apps that I've developed so that they are working better as snapped apps with something else than they work on their own. And that's something that makes an app really, really, really fluid and available to users to do other things with and to extend their experience of the device. So when you're adding a snap view, you're looking at 320 pixel width, and based on the layout. Now, if the device itself only has a 1024 by 768 screen, snap is not available. Okay, but if it has a screen resolution that's 1366 or higher, it will be able to handle the snap view. So basically, your layout is set so that they can either snap it to the left or to the right. You really have to look at what controls you're using in your major view to make sure that they properly handle what they need to do in the snap view. So for example, in a control where you're using a grid view control when you're snapping it, you may want to use a list view control so that it looks more effective and it's just a little easier for the users to use, and it makes more sense in that particular scenario because the items will be laid out vertically. So adding a portrait view, the layout should be optimized to 9 by 16, and you should really try to decrease your margins, right? So you should be looking at ways of making sure that the content takes up more of the screen. If you try to keep the same margins that you're going to have in a landscape application, the application will look very squished and very, very contained. So you're using a lot of things like list-based layouts and really, really trying to keep anything that's non-list-based to a maximum of 2 columns. One of the really, really neat things is in HTML5 is you have the ability to do CSS media queries. So you basically, it allows you to really quickly and easily lay out in your CSS what those snapped and portrait view look like in your CSS. And without writing any extra code to handle it, it basically just automatically handles it. As soon as it reaches one of the view states that matches your media query, you basically, your CSS will take over and apply the views and the control layouts accordingly. So in XAML, we have the visual state manager that does that. So we're looking at basically setting up what our visual state looks like for full screen, for filled, for snapped, and for portrait. We can define those within those visual state views, manager views rather. And you can also have orientation helpers. So you can do basically a get view state, and you can see what the current orientation of the property is by using the display properties. You can also use the application layout, and you can also use the application view state to check to see whether the view state is application view state of value to see what the actual value is showing you. And so one of the other things that we were talking about before was scaling things to properly fit. So one of the big things that you want to think about is pixel density and making sure that you're properly utilizing controls and the elements to properly lay out an immersive experience depending on, no matter what the screen size is. So we don't want something that's built to 1366 to scale to 1920 by 1080 and now be all stretched out of shape and look horrible. So what you're looking at is trying to keep aware of the fact too that as the pixel density gets greater, the controls get smaller. So you have to be aware of that so that you're properly scaling and sizing things so that given a bigger monitor or a more pixel density rather, that they don't lose the ability to properly use it through touch. The last thing you want to do is have someone with a really, really great monitor, a really great or great tablet have a hard time utilizing your application because the pixel density on their tablet is too high. So you want to basically make sure that it basically scales properly, and you want to set the scaling to be aware of on any screen to utilize the extra pixels to give a nice crisp, clear view of the controls and the fonts and the images. as you can see here. If we were trying to just stretch one out without scaling it properly, we would end up having a much more blurry accounting of the fonts. And that brings us right down to user experience. So Windows will scale controls to properly protect the pixel density, especially using the view box. It ends up being a really great control to utilize that scaling ability. Setting out your layouts and test images so that they are easily touch enabled allows them to be better laid out, better viewed, and better enjoyed at the higher pixel densities, because they'll end up being crisper and clearer. And you've got three scale percentages, okay? So you have the 135 dpi, you have the 190 dpi, and you have the 253 dpi, or the 100, 140, and 180. And you can actually set images specifically for those pixel densities within your application so that you don't have to stretch them out in order to be properly used. So your layouts are automatically scaled, but you have to ensure that your image rendering are crisp by including different images. One of the great ways to do it is to use CSS primitives or SVG. And also in bitmaps, you can use resource loading. So you can actually automatically have the application swap the bitmap based on the naming convention that you use for the bitmap and what scaling it's set at. So for example here, we're able to see loading different images for pixel density. So we've got our foo.scale-100, 140, and 180. Those will be automatically loaded by the system so that it gets properly identified and properly laid out without causing any pixelation or any loss of quality or clarity on the object. So again, one of the things we want to be aware of is all the design built-in controls are designed for touch as well as mouse and keyboard. So you should be looking at your touch forward interface and realize that the mouse and the keyboard are just coming along. So you've got a bunch of different standard touch interactions. So you've got the press and hold, right? It's usually press and hold to get more information. So that's when things like tooltips will pop up, or you can have a flyout with more information. You can have a tap for primary action, which is usually buttons or different controls. You've got slide to drag, so in order to get more, to move things from one thing to another. Swiping down is selecting. So if you've got a list view item or a grid view item, when users swipe down, that selects a particular item. You can also pinch to zoom, which is great because that activates your semantic zoom if you set your application up to utilize that feature. And then you have the ability to set up rotate. So the pinch to rotate is a very, very interesting and it's a big favorite as far as I've seen from users, being able to pinch and rotate things. Now, if you swipe in from the edge, from the outer right-hand edge, you're going to get the settings or the charms bar, which will give you the settings, devices, search, and the window charm as well. And swiping swiping up from the bottom will give you your app bars. So it'll give you both your top and bottom app bars will come down at the same time. So you have the ability, with simple gestures that users are familiar with, the system will respond to it and utilize those within your application. So what you really want to do is make sure that you're thinking about touch first. You're making sure that you're using MS Pointer events to make sure that you get the code, and your code is reactive to both the touch, the mouse, and the pen all in the exact same way. So you're not recoding things. You don't have to recode things for every single thing. You just utilize the one event set. And then use the MS gestures to get access to easy reactions and gestures from the users, so that you can actually make a really, really interesting and immersive experience. And it's always fun to experiment with the gestures to see what else you can give the users and what things you can come up with to make the users have more fun and enjoy the application that much more. So animations, another big thing, another big feature of Windows 8. Basically, you can utilize these to create some really, really nice beauty and some really fun interactions with the user, and give the user that sort of wow feature in your application, and give it a lot of personality. So adding custom design styles and animations to your application is really, really easy, because there's a huge built-in animation library that's already included in Windows 8, and you have full access to that. So you have the ability to do all sorts of different transforms and scales and moves and all sorts of different things. So we'll take a quick look at the animation library. It's also part of the Windows library for JavaScript, or the WinJS. So it's also it also has all of the key style app animations that you need to be able to quickly and easily access them inside your application code. And has the same storyboard values and curves, and all of the different features that are utilized in all the animations across the platforms are the same, whether it's HTML5, whether it's XAML in CSS, or whether it's in C++. And it allows you to really sort of interact and sort of become part of the Windows 8 experience, and which is one of the things that when I talk about people when they're building apps, when I talk to them, I say one of the things that you cannot go wrong with is making sure the application just does what's expected. So, as a recap, I know I've been talking on forever and you guys are probably all exhausted, but just about done, and we're just going to go through a couple of quick little things here. You got to really think about utilizing the built-in controls and making sure that you utilize the best there is available to enhance your design, to utilize some really, really nice, great design features. I like it as a fact that I'm not a designer, and I find that it's really easy to use these design controls, the animations, and all the other things to create really, really rich and beautiful applications that previously I just didn't have the controls and the ability at my disposal to be able to do. I'm able to do much more now with it. You can also definitely have to look at building UI that's really, really reflexive, flexible rather, and really reflects the screen size properly that you're using. So you're not basically just stretching out your app to fit a bigger screen, that you're actually making use of the better resolution or the bigger screen size to the user's advantage and to your advantage. And last but not, or definitely not one of the least things, always design for touch. Design for touch, because touch is basically where things are going. We all have tablets, we all have phones, we all have devices that use touch now, and touch is becoming more and more prevalent. So design for touch, and also take into account that there's keyboard and mouse, but touch is the big thing that you have to focus on, because it's a new paradigm. We're all used to developing and designing our applications for keyboards and mice. So think about touch. Think about touch first, the keyboard and mouse will come. So as I had said before, that touch is really easy to use, built in with all the gestures and the pointer events and all the different things that are available. You're building it once, you're coding it once, and it reacts to all three. So one of the other things that you want to also try and incorporate is adding animation really enriches your application to make sure that you have all of those features and all of those things to attract and entice and engage the users, which is what we're all trying to do. And that's the session evaluation. So what I'd really like you to do is, if you like this presentation, or even if you didn't like this presentation, I want to hear from you. I want you to go in, do a session evaluation. I want you to let me know, what did I do well? What did I do wrong? What can I do to improve it? What information did I miss? What things aren't here that you really wanted to know? Or maybe what we'll do is we'll make another session, or we'll find out a way to get that information to you. So if you go into here, your feedback matters. Make sure that you go down to the URL down at the bottom here, aka.ms.devc2, and let us know. I really want to know, okay? So thank you very much for spending some time with me. Sorry I'm a little long-winded, but those of people that know me know I tend to talk for a long time. Thank you very much.